Have you not known? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, neither faints nor is weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, he increases strength. Even the youths shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
The whale is coming where the eagle is. This is just part of them. But I'm going to go in the whale next week. I'm going to preach on from the bottom to the top. Anybody want to go to the top? And I will be swallowed in this whale, and it will be back right in the middle. You don't want to miss next week. How many is excited about coming to church? So last week we talked about eagles, we talked about how they mate, we talked about their eyes, we talked about brilliance, and we talked about so many good things, and how that the scripture bears out that God uses the eagle and shows us how he takes care of us. 89 scripture verses in the Bible that refer to the eagle. God loves the eagle. God, of course, loves all of his creation. Today we're going to learn about how to fly. We're going to learn about renewal. We're going to learn about how the eagle does that and how God uses scripture verses that it will affect your life and my life. Now, the eagle's nest is a very interesting home, of course, to the eagle. The fact is that it takes 6 months to build a nest. And even though there are 60 species of the eagle, each eagle and each species has the same experience in building the nest, building the home. What happens after, as we learned last week, the eagles, as they get married or they mate, and they start, the mother, the father, the male, the female, they start building the nest. Now, what is very interesting about this nest is it is usually built on an edge of a cliff, or it is built in a high place in which that the nest is sticking out where there is lots of room for the nest as it sticks out for someone to throw something out, or the eagle, if it should fall, it would literally fall to its death. So keeps the eaglets in because of the of how high the nest is. One of the things about the nest is that when they begin to build it, they, of course, what you see here, they build that, and it's usually a foot to 2 to 3 foot, depends upon the eagle, in depth. The first foundation in the nest, because it has to be in a secluded place and in a strong place because it's a very heavy nest. The eagles will bring rocks. They'll bring sharp objects. They'll even bring thorns, and they put it in the foundation of the eagle's nest. There's a reason for that, which we will discover in just a moment, but that's how they start building the nest when it comes into the inside of the nest. Then they go out and they get feathers and rabbit skins and wolf skins and skins of animals, the eagle, whether they kill it or they find it. And they begin to fill the basket on top of the foundation with feathers and with skins. And the eagle's nest becomes very, very, very soft and attractive. You could call it the penthouse of the skies. It is incredible. Then the female then lays eggs. There's no more than three eggs. Sometimes, most of the time, it's two eggs. More female eagles or eaglets are born than male. And usually only one or two survive if there's three or four, which is very unusual if there's four being birthed at the same time. The mother is very, very strong about watching over it. The father then goes and gets the food and he brings it, and it's an exciting moment. Now the eagles are born. They're hatched from the egg, and the eaglets start moving around inside the penthouse suite. And it's soft and it's cozy, and the eaglets begin to grow week after week, and they have a blast. Mom and dad go out and get Whoppers and White Castles and goes out and gets their favorite shoops, and they feed them every day. They have DoorDash every single day, the eaglets do. It's the most incredible experience. They don't have to pay the light bill. They don't have to pay the fish bill. They don't have to pay anything. The eaglets start making the nest a soccer field, a football field, and these eaglets absolutely have the time of their life. 6 weeks old, 7 weeks old, now 10 weeks old, and they're just thrilled. Mom and dad takes care of them, and they're just enjoying life. And they get about 14 weeks, and it just can't get any better than what's going on. Mom and dad are proud of the eaglets, of course, and then there is the eaglets that are proud of the parents. The Bible says in Deuteronomy, it says these words. It says, as an eagle stirreth up her nest, in the 32nd chapter and the 11th verse, as an eagle stirreth up her nest, fluttereth over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, and taketh them and beareth them on her wings. In other words, what is happening here as the Lord is telling us, you and I, this is what he does to you and I. In fact, the next verse says that, so the Lord alone did lead him, and there was no strange God with him, talking about how he was leading his people. Using the eagle as an illustration, goes on to the 13th verse, he made him ride on the high places of the earth that he might eat the increase. I just want to say to everyone that believes in God, God wants to take you higher, and God wants you to have increase. If you will look at the scriptures, you will see what God wants for your life. He makes him ride on the high places of the earth, that he might eat the increase. When you get born again, when you come to God, God intends to correct your poverty and to turn it into increase in your life. Every phase of your life, God wants to take you higher. And regardless of where you are in life, in that comfortable position, and all of us do, we get into habits, we get into the flow of life, and then we start experiencing that God starts doing stuff in our life. At any age, at any given time, God will start messing up your nest. He will start dealing with your habits. He will start dealing with things are going great and wonderful. Then all of a sudden, the mother and the father that you love and has fed you and given you a great living, all of a sudden the mother comes down in the nest one day because she's going to stir up the nest. It's time to go to the next level. And she becomes, looks like a demon-possessed eagle. She comes down among her children and she starts taking the rabbit skins out. She starts taking the feathers out. She starts getting that nest where they built that nest where there was thorns and there was rocks in the bottom of that nest. Those little eaglets, they 14 weeks out there, they're screaming, "This hurts, stop it, what are you doing?" And she's flapping her wings and slinging them from side to side. She's trying to get them to come up on the edge of the nest. And she's trying to make it uncomfortable that their feet hurt, and it's a terrible, terrible environment now. And they're screaming and yelling going on in this house of the eagles, of kids saying, "Mom, you have lost your mind." And mom is quickly, with the father flying around, fluttering her wings, frustrating these eagles, because mom is getting ready to teach these eagles, along with dad, how to fly. But they don't like it. And let me just say this. You get comfortable sometimes in life, and God will come down and mess your comfort up, because he wants to take you somewhere. And things begin to happen that's weird in your life. You begin to say, "What in the world is going on? I gave my tithe and I went to church, and my goodness, all of a sudden my health, all of a sudden my family, all of a sudden my job, all of a sudden my finances, all of a sudden things begin to go wacky." Well, the Bible says in 1 Peter, it says concerning fiery trials, it says, "Beloved, think it not strange when you go through fiery trials, which has tried you as though some strange thing has happened unto you." The next verse says, "But rejoice." In other words, he's telling you, rejoice when things are not going like you want them to go, because I got a plan, and the only way I can get you to the next level is mess up your present. Because your habits, what you've been doing, that's maybe good, but God wants to take you up higher. The Bible also says in 1 Corinthians, it talks about things that come into our life, and Apostle Paul talks about it when he talks about, he says, "There hath no temptation taken you," the 10th chapter and the 13th verse. This is messing up the nest. This is the stirring of the nest. "There hath no temptation taken you, but such is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above all you are able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it." Here's what he's saying. He's saying, look, what you're going through, it's going to be all right. I would never put on you no more than you can bear. And you don't like what's going on right now, but I am getting you to the point in which, where your comfort zone is, I'm going to get you uncomfortable. Because I'm getting ready to teach you to fly in a new zone, fly in a new area, to fly somewhere you've never been before. I'm talking to somebody right now. It's not going well for you. There is a crack in the marriage. There is a decision being made. There is frustration. There is depression. There's a habit you can't break. There's a money barrier, seems like, in your life you cannot obtain. There are things in which the frustration has begun to happen, and it's God messing up your nest. And you're screaming, "It hurts." These eaglets are screaming, "It hurt, my feet hurt." And mama comes down and she says, "I'm taking everything out of here. I'm taking your bottles. I'm taking your diapers out of here. And these pacifiers, they have got to go. Because I'm getting ready to do something of a new thing in your life." So the Bible teaches us, don't think it's strange that when some strange thing happens to you that seems like, what in the world, this lawsuit, this court situation, my child is in trouble, what is going on? God has got something, and he would not put on you more than you can bear, so just get ready. He's messing up your nest, and he's trying to get you in a position to start to fly where you've never flown before. The eaglets now, the nest is completely bare of its of the niceness and comfort, and the eaglets are forced because their feet are hurting. They're coming up on the edge of the nest. They've noticed something else. The eaglets have noticed something else, that they haven't been fed in a day or two. Where is my food? Where is my money? What's the deal? And the eaglets are up on the edge, and you can imagine those eaglets, much like us, look down and go, ooh, wow, I better hold on for dear life. Looks like I would die if I fell out of this nest. You must understand that it is good, it is very good what mama's doing, even though it looks like it's horrible. And if you're wearing diapers in your house at 21 years of age, it's time to fly. If you're sucking your thumb at 10 years of age, it's time to change some things. And the Bible says when training a child, that if you train that child, it will never veer from it, and you should train the child. And all of you that have children or about to have children, or and let me just pause here to say, you can't start training them when they're 16. You can't do that. And you have Google Gaga and bought them more toys than they can get in their room. And the day comes, you need to teach them, and you need to teach them at a young age, and in teaching them messing up the nest, you need to chastise them, not when they get 13. That's too late. And I'm talking about abuse. The Bible says that he loves those that he chastises. In other words, God will chastise you only because he loves you and wants to take you to another level. I'm not talking about abuse, but it doesn't start at 21. You can't tell a 30-year-old, I'm going to whip you because you don't have any manners. And you need to teach children what a fork is, and a spoon, and a knife, and a napkin. And you need to teach them that they don't talk with their mouth full of food at the table. And there's nothing wrong in teaching them to say, yes, sir, and no, sir. I'm amazed when I go and I'm checking out at a checkout place and I'll say, thank you, ma'am. And many times the lady will say, did you just call me ma'am? It's like a foreign word. We got to get beyond our rapping ways of making up words. The other day I was with a group of young men, and they were complimenting what I was doing. They said, that's dope. And I said, oh my God, is there a cop around? What dope? What are you talking about, dope? Changing words, and I'm not taking away from what certain meanings are, but we need to get back to the simplicity of, you need to learn how to say thank you. You need to learn how to say that was nice. You need to say I appreciate you. And that doesn't, they don't catch it in school. They don't catch it with their friends. You have to teach it. My dad was the fastest man alive with his belt. He could draw his belt faster. He could unbuckle it and slam it and draw it through those hoops of his pants faster than any person that I have ever witnessed. I have gotten whippings. I probably needed the whippings. He whipped me. He would tell me, teach me. You have to have manners. I grew up when I was young having manners. I'm afraid not to say no, sir, and no, ma'am, and I was not in the Army. I just think that if we're going to change a generation of eagle, now if you want to be a duck and a chicken, you just talk any way you want to talk. But if you're going to be an eagle and stand out, you train, you discipline, you teach. All of you parents and grandparents, you don't ask your kids at they're 12 years old, would you like to go to church today? Of course they're going to say, no, I don't want to go to church. I want to play my video game. You have to discipline them. You have to say, hey, let me just tell you what's going on here. We have what we have because God gave it to us. This is not a game. They say, well, my kids, they don't like spirituality. You have to teach them about spirituality. You have to teach them there is a God. There is a God. You have to teach them that. Now, if 18, if they want a damn God, they want to go to college and never come back to God, that's not your responsibility. But it is your responsibility to teach those eaglets how to fly. When they want the keys to the car, tell them, take the trash out. I see everybody, I wouldn't do that. They would run away from home. That's the problem. That's the reason why they'll still be there at 50 years of age in your house, because you've got to train them. Train them. Wash the dishes. What? I don't know how to wash. I'll put them in the dishwasher. No, wash the dishes. Here's $30. I'll give you the sneakers only if you wash it. You train. Something that's uncomfortable in life is going to make the individual better. And training them how to worship, training them how to give. Cheyenne and I get up at 6. She goes with me, comes to church at 6 o'clock. She gets up on her own. I don't get her up. She's waiting for me as I leave. And we have a kind of a routine. She knows our routine. And I go to the bank to get some Jesus money. I give her money. And then I teach her about the tithe. She gets every month or every week some allowance from me. And I said, now 10% is God's. And then I said, you can give anything you want. 50 cents, a dollar, whatever. You teach your children. Don't wait for somebody just for them to catch it. You teach them. If you want your children blessed, they don't catch it. They got to be taught it. And sometimes it's uncomfortable. But what may be uncomfortable today may be remarkable tomorrow. The eaglet is there. And they're hungry, and they are miserable. They're screaming at their mother and their father with a circle in the sky. And on purpose, they don't bring the Chick-fil-A today. And they haven't had anything to eat in a day or so, these eaglets, who won't go back in the nest because their feet hurt, and they're on the edge of the nest. Now mama comes with a big whopper. It is a rabbit, and she's got it in her claws, and she comes down and swoops toward the eaglets, and they try to jump, and they hold on for dear life. Now, mother keeps doing that until they get so hungry, they jump at that food, and they never get it but fall out of the nest, and they start falling over and over and over, screaming, ah! The ground starts coming closer and closer and closer and closer, and that's when Daddy flies down and catches them with his wings. You remember last week when the female tested the male if he could catch the branch? That was the whole deal. You'll be a good father that when the eaglet falls, you will catch him before he hits the ground. You may feel like you're falling today, but I got good news for you. Your father has got wings. He's going to catch you. He's going to catch you before you fall. The father then flies back up and dumps the eagle back in the nest. They get back up on the edge, and they start screaming at their mother, "You no good. You tricked me. You can't believe it. I can't stand you. What's wrong with you, mama? And daddy, you too. You're backing her up." but I'm hungry. Get me something to eat. We'll do it again. And sure enough, the eaglet will jump. And sure enough, it'll fall out again of the nest. And it starts doing somersaults, scared, screaming. And let me just say to everybody, when you get out of your comfort zone, you will scream inside. A new job, a new opportunity, a new thing. You're just wondering, oh, my. But don't worry. God's got you. He's got you. He's got eagle wings. He's going to catch you. And as they begin to go over screaming and yelling, and the parents are just looking, and all of a sudden that eaglet will just start, unbeknownst to the eaglet, its wings, it'll start flapping its wings. And all of a sudden when it starts flapping its wings, it starts slowing down toward the ground. And all of a sudden it really, really, really flaps its wings. And then all of a sudden he didn't hit the ground. And daddy doesn't catch him. He starts elevating. He starts going slower. And he looks around. Look at me. Daddy. And he starts climbing. And he starts climbing. And he starts laughing. Oh, look at me. I believe I can fly. I don't know who I'm talking to today, but if you think everything's out of control, God has given you spiritual wings and you're about to soar. Oh, who is about to soar like an eagle? And what you thought was bad turned out for the good. And what the enemy meant for evil, God meant for good. And whatever you're going, if it's a health issue, if it's a doctor's bad report, if it's a bank issue, if it's a child, whatever it is, it's all on purpose, because here's what Jesus said. Jesus said these words, everything you go through, and Jesus referred to it as tribulation. He said, every tribulation, every trial, every problem, every situation you go through life, Jesus said it. He said, I have already overcome it. What is he saying? I paid the price. If you're sick, you can be healed. If you're poor, you can be rich. If you're in a situation that you feel like is a crisis of death, God is going to bring life. Whoever you are today, you feel like the ground is coming up. You're wondering if you're going to die in this situation. Well, there's two good answers to that. Your Father will swoop down and save you just in time. But more than that, he's given you the wings of an eagle. And you're going to fly higher and stronger and bigger. So every situation you go through, it's on purpose. It's uncomfortable to have bad health. It's uncomfortable to be in certain situations. But God has designed it to say, let me tell you something. I've already overcome it. I'm going to put wings on you. And I'm going to tell you that you are my child, and you may think I've forsaken you. You think that I haven't done it. You think I haven't come on time, but everything is under control, and I'm getting ready to do a miracle, and you're going to fly above the storm. Somebody give Jesus a great big hand clap. The Bible talks about, but they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. An eagle can live to be 70 years of age. The eagle enjoys the great, wonderful power of flying above the storm. Its power and strength is incredible, that eagle is. But there comes a time in everyone's life, it doesn't matter who you are, you're going to have to renew in your life. There will come times that when you hit 45, you realize that your stomach starts acting funny. For some of you, 35, you have to buy gas pills. You've been eating potato chips all your life, 3 bags a week, and all of a sudden your body starts saying weird sounds, comes out at unique places. The body starts changing with cavities and the teeth, and all of a sudden our fingers begin to not operate, and you're going to have to go through a stage in which you're going to have to make up in your mind, am I going to let this get me, or am I going to be renewed to get it? You're going to go through letdowns with friends and people who you depended upon. You're going to go through times in which not even your family understands you. You're going to be rejected. Let me just say to everybody, you need to learn to walk alone with Jesus. Your phone can be so addicting that you give no time being alone because you got everybody's number on speed dial. And everyone on speed dial is the one you talk to about every one of your problems. And you spend hours discussing it and they can't do a thing for you. They only add to the frustration. Trying to be and say what would comfort you, and it doesn't do a bit of good. When you get with Jesus, when Jesus is in your life, let me tell you, he's bigger than a crowd. He's bigger than stadiums that have 100,000 people. Because the Bible says, if he is for you, what can be against you? You and God are a majority. When you get to that place when you're going through times in which job and age and children and mortgage payments and inflation and what is going on and how come the washing machine goes out at the same time the car goes out? Why can't one of them go out at one time and the car go out another? Why does it all happen? Why does the commode stop at the same time the washing machine doesn't work and the flat tire is on my car? It just seems like everything has piled up and it's all caving in. And every one of us, everybody, nobody is exempt from that. I don't care how rich you are, I don't care how popular you are, I don't care who, where you live, etc. You're going to go through, and God is going to give you an opportunity to renew yourself. And you can't blame the devil, your wife, your mother-in-law, or your husband. It is totally up to you that when the doctor tells you you got cancer, you got to make up in your mind, okay, you tell me I got cancer. Well, let me tell you, I'm going to beat cancer because I read somewhere by his stripes, Jesus' stripes, I will be healed. You can cave into the arthritis. You can cave into the dementia. You can cave into the rejection of foreclosure and feel like you're a failure because you've had foreclosure, car picked up, etc. Did you know that Walt Disney 11 times went bankrupt. 11 times. Which time did he give up? Which time did he say, I'll never be able to renew my strength? I just want to tell you, you can't blame anybody. Don't blame yourself even. Begin to say, I'm going to renew myself. I'm going to renew. I, as the Bible says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength, shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. We all get weary. We all get tired. We all get frustrated. We all get rejected. We all go through hell. Our children are not right, our husband, our wives, our schools, our government, on our block, everything, anything will go crazy. But the only ones that make it in life are the ones that don't fly with the flocks or live in the barnyard with all the negative people, but are eagles that fly alone above the problem. Above the storm. Am I talking to any eagles here today? The eagle, when it gets 40 years of age, starts losing its feathers. It can live to be 70. You know, I'm reminded of Joshua 14 and 11, Caleb. You that are Bible readers, and let me freshen your memory, or let me tell you that have never heard about Caleb. Caleb was 40 years of age, he and Joshua. Moses said, take the dream, take the land of milk and honey. And Moses was leading 2 million people, and Moses said, I want to send 12 men to spy the land out of milk and honey and increase. And God had already said, you're going to get it. I just want to say to somebody, I read to you today, God wants you to have the increase. I'm going to say it again. God wants you to live on the increase. I'm going to say it again. God wants to give you increase. You better get your mouth open. You better start saying, I believe that. And the Bible says they sent 12 spies out. And for you that remember, 10 of the spies came back and they said, we can't take it. We can't do the dream. It's too big. They said that to Moses. But there were two men that said, we can take the land, Moses. Most of you know their name. Their name is Joshua and Caleb. Fast track 40 years later. Because the 10 were nothing but ducks, excuse me, who quacked loud enough to make 2 million more ducks. And they quacked negativity after God had said, I'm giving you the land. I'm giving you the money, honey, milk. And so God did this. God would not allow them to go into the increase for 40 years. In fact, the history says 100 people died a day. 100. And God made sure that every negative person would not go into the promised land. And 2 million died in 40 years. While another generation came up. There was only 2 old men when they took the promised land. They were 80 years of age. You know who they were? Joshua and Caleb. Meaning, if you're negative, listen to this, if you're negative, oh, it's never gonna happen, I don't believe it, I don't believe all of that, just want to tell you, we will never remember you. You will be forgotten. Only people who have faith, who are the positive of the land, we can overcome. We remember Martin Luther King because he said, I have a dream. It will happen. We will get to the promised land. Every black boy and every white boy and every Catholic, every Protestant, Jew or Gentile, will walk hand in hand in the promised land. And Martin Luther King is never forgotten. They got statues in Washington. You're negative, you hang with negative people, you will be forgotten. Grass will grow over your grave, and not even your great-grandchildren will know who you are. But if you become an eagle, they can't even fathom the greatness that's in your life when you're an eagle. Let me read you a scripture verse when he was 80. Because this is what happens to you in life to renew. Caleb said, I am still as strong today, he's 80 now, as I was in the day that Moses sent me. My strength now is my strength was then. For war, for going, coming. Moses was 120 years, this is in the scriptures in Deuteronomy. Moses was 120 years old when he died, and his eyes was undimmed. His vigor unabated. He was as strong at 120 as he was 50. Caleb is saying, I'm as strong at 80 as I am at 40. I just want to tell all of you that are creeping up to the age, you don't have to die. You can live. You can be strong. Renew. The Bible says, God said, I'll renew you. And you know what an eagle has to do? If the eagle makes the decision, but this eagle's got to make the decision. The feathers are falling out. The beak has grown at 40 years of age until he cannot eat anymore. His claws he can't pick up because, other than me explaining, his toenails have grown so long he can't function in the hunt. But if this eagle says, I want to renew, I want to mount up with new wings, his feathers are falling, he'll fly to a place that'll take 100 days alone. 100 days alone. And he will fly to a place where there's a rock. He will make up in his mind, I will be renewed. I will be young. I will conquer this health issue. I will conquer this habit. I will overcome. And he will take every eagle that wants to live, will start beating his beak against the rock. His head will explode with migraine pains. Blood starts running out. The pain is so severe, but he knows, I gotta beat this old beak off on this rock, because there's a new beak on the inside. And he pounds himself. I don't know who I'm talking to. You're going through somewhere you've never been, but you just keep beating that beak against the rock. And then the beak falls off. The old one, the new beak, he has to stay there long enough that it starts functioning and he can eat again. He reaches down and trims his toenails and his feet. His feathers are not good, but now he can eat again, and he goes after the food and his feathers grow back. You can't tell an old eagle from a young eagle. May I tell you, you've got to go to a place where there's a rock, and that rock is Christ Jesus, and you've got to give up that situation. And the Bible says that God, that when we begin to cry out to him, Lord, break this habit. Lord, break this poverty. God, break this curse. And it's lonely and nobody knows what you're going through, but it's a closet of prayer. And that eagle just makes up his mind. You hear me today? You got to make up in your mind. God can't do it for you. The devil can't do it for you. Your husband, your wife, your mom, your dad, they can't do it for you. You got to make up in your mind. I'm going to call things that are not as though they were. I will fly again. I will fly again. I will be back on my feet again. Stand to your feet and give Jesus a great big hand clap. Everybody in the house, turn all the lights on. Come on, clap. You're going to fly. You're going to be renewed. Today, there's a rock. It's right here at the altar. Come and beat that old habit you've been trying to break. Come and bring the dream back. Come and break the negativity. Come and break the unforgiveness that has made you old and featherless. Come, for the Bible says, if you will draw nigh to me, I will draw nigh to you. Talking to somebody today, it's up to you, not up to your girlfriend, not up to your father. It's up to you. You got to do this alone. You got to go somewhere alone. And today, this altar is the place you want to come. The beak will break today, and God will give you a new dimension and a new healing and a new way to fly. Because he said, I will renew you. And when you get weary, you won't quit. I'm talking to a mother. I know you're single parent. How you raise your children is just unbelievable. How you work and get them up early and go to school and do it by yourself. You cry yourself to sleep. But I got some good news for you, mother. You're an eagle. God's getting ready to do something big in your life. You that have been given a bad doctor's report, you that are struggling for your health, for something in life, today I have a prayer. I've been told by the Holy Spirit, if you come, God will put fresh feathers. He'll put a healing. He'll put a deliverance. You may not know much about this, but it's real simple. You come to God, God will come to you. And he knows exactly where you are. Don't be ashamed. Don't be a duck. Don't wait for another duck to do it. Be an eagle. Eagles don't fly in flocks. I don't care if you do it or not. This is what I want to do. I want a miracle. I'm going to the rock, which is higher than I. Jesus. When I count to three, come on, eagle. Come on, weary eagle. Come on, eagle that's discouraged. Come on, eagle that's been let down. Come on back and watch God do a miracle today. So when I count to three, leave wherever you're standing, get to an aisle and come, because God's about to do something incredible. One, two, three, come.
So I lower my head and praise you again and again.
People are coming. By the hundreds, they're coming. Come on, eagle.
Hallelujah.
Come on, teenager.
Hallelujah.
Come on, mom. Come on, single
girl.
Come on, single dad.
Except for a heart.
Come on, break that habit today. Come on. Get him come from the balcony. Oh, somebody get excited. Come on, congregation. Clap your hands to Jesus today. All the people that are coming to the Lord and touch. Let the congregation and all of those that are watching. And Jay, I hope that you keep us on the air, because the whole world needs to see the eagles that have come. Most of these are weary and tired and fought the battle. But today, you're going to take flight. You're going to go a different direction. And everybody that believes that, shout a great big amen.
Amen.
Everybody in the audience, I'm going to let you go, because I really want to pray with these just for a few moments. So can we all lift our right hand and say these words? Oh God.
Oh God.
You made me an eagle.
You made me an eagle.
I will.
I will.
Fly above the storm.
Fly above the storm.
I know.
I know.
You are with me.
You are with me.
You will not let me.
You will not let me.
Hit the ground.
Hit the ground.
You'll catch me.
You'll catch me.
I love you, Lord.
I love you, Lord.
I'm going to thank you.
And I'm going to thank you.
This month.
This month.
In November.
In November.
More thanks.
More thanks.
More thank yous.
More thank yous.
Than I've ever done before.
Than I've ever done before.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Are you glad you came to church today? Are you glad you came to church? Wednesday night, you'll get a prophetic word. One of the most powerful prophets from Columbia. Next week, I'll be in the whale from the bottom to the top, and all of you can be dismissed quietly while this altar is so packed. Jay, make sure that you show the world this, and all of you, if you don't mind, put your hand on your heart. We're going to start in this moment in which God is about to change. And I'd like for you to say with a confession with your mouth to say, oh Lord Jesus.
Oh Lord Jesus.
I come today.
I come today.
I believe.
I believe.
My miracle.
My miracles.
I believe.
I believe.
You're about to do a new thing.
You're about to do a new thing.
In my life.
In my life.
Forgive me.
Forgive me.
Cleanse me.
Cleanse me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For making me feel uncomfortable.
For making me feel uncomfortable.
I've learned today.
I've learned today.
You stirred up my nest.
You stirred up my nest.
And I'm going to fly.
And I'm going to fly.
And in the name of Jesus.
And in the name of Jesus.
If there's anything in my heart.
If there's anything in my heart.
Forgive me.
Forgive me.
Cleanse me.
Cleanse me.
For I believe. You're the Son of the living God.
You are the Son of the living God.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I declare.
My miracle.
Is going to come upon me.
It's going to come upon me.
Now. I'd like for you to lift your hands. Both hands, close your eyes. Begin to say, thank you, Jesus. They're going to sing it. But the Holy Spirit is going to come upon you. I'm praying it. Here it comes. Here comes the power of God. In the name of Jesus.
Father, let the power of the Holy Spirit come upon you. Again and again.
Break habits, teach.
Let
the healing come into their body. Heal their bodies. Heal their bodies. Touch them in the name of Jesus. Let the power of the Holy Spirit let the power of the Holy Spirit fall upon them. Let the miracle happen upon everyone. Everyone. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, receive it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
All that I have is a
miracle. We receive it. Receive the miracle. Receive it right now. Oh, sing it. Sing it. Yes. Oh, hallelujah.
Receive the miracle.
Oh, yes.
Except for a heart singing hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Those of you who got your hands up, bring them down. Open your eyes. We're going to fly now. All of you are going to fly right now. Some of you are going to have to be pushed out of the nest, but you're going to fly. You know how you fly? You fly with faith. Faith is something hopeful and the evidence of things not seen. Today, you're going to fly. You're going to believe. You're going to confess it with your mouth. And you're going to say, I know my miracle has come. Even if you have no evidence. Are you hearing me? You have no evidence right now. But the Bible says, speak those things that are not as though they were. For you eagles that believe that God, and most of you have been through a nesting story, I want you to declare these words. I know it's going to happen. Say that with me. I know it's going to happen. Here's how you fly. This is how you ignite God's Spirit. That you actually believe he's going to do it. And you don't have any tangible evidence of the money. Now, sometimes in healing, you can feel the healing right away or the miracle. But you believe. You believe. Here he comes. He's coming down like an eagle. He's knocking you out of your nest. And you're going to start flying in a new money world, in a new job world, in a new relationship world. And the old peak is passed away. The old life, the old way is passed away. Everybody say, passed away.
Passed away.
God is about to do a new thing. This message was for you. Now, how do I begin to fly, Pastor? You fly with thanking God and showing him, I believe you have done it in my life. That's how you begin to fly. So on the count of three, seal the deal. You ready? Don't wait on anybody else. Don't look around because you're not a duck no more. You're going to take the flight. What I'd like for you to do is start clapping your hands and start saying hallelujah. Ready? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, let's fly! Hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus! last thing I'm going to tell you. Some of you have been in the barnyard so long, you've lived with the snakes. But let me tell you something. Did you know that snakes can only crawl so high in altitude? When God makes an eagle out of you, you fly higher than the snakes. That means you fly higher than the devil. You fly higher than that situation. And today you walk out of here. You're an eagle. Don't you dare start talking like a duck again. Don't worry about what the crowd thinks. Only worry about the one that is making you a brand new eagle. To restore, for some of you, he's going to restore many things in your life. And everybody at the altar say, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
All of you, you better get ready, because something special is going to happen to every one of you. How many is glad you came to the altar today? Elders, would you hold up that card? This helps us to continue to believe with you. If you want to be baptized, we baptize. If you want me to pray with you as others do, you write your name down and we continue the journey. If you'd like to join the church, of course we want you to join, but if you want us to help you, pray with you, you want us to believe with you, it'll take about 30 seconds. They got a pen, they got a card. We'll stand here and sing. But God bless every one of you. Don't miss Wednesday night. That's going to be great. Go fly, Eagles. God bless you. Go fly.
Well, today I hope, in fact, the last two Sundays, that you have been blessed. If you stayed with us both Sundays in the message of the eagle, next week's going to be great too, because we are in the month of Thanksgiving, and I have made a tremendous pledge to God in my prayer that I would do everything in my power to get the people to thank God more than they've ever thanked Him. And so Wednesday night is a service of thanksgiving. 2 weeks, in 2 weeks is our meal with Jesus. That's going to be very important. I'm calling all attenders, all of those that attend Family Christian Center, to be there. I know college students are coming home. I know relatives are coming from out of town. I know it's busy. I know traffic is absolutely crazy. And I know it's difficult on that Wednesday night because it's not normal. But I'm asking every single person to prove to Him, we're going to eat our Thanksgiving meal with you, Jesus. And it's going to be on Wednesday night with our holy sacraments, and to stand there and to say thank you. It won't be a long service, but it'll be a service long enough for us to let Him know we are thankful. We are thankful. And nobody is too busy not to come and say, Lord, we're thankful. In fact, we could do that a lot more, but that Wednesday night's gonna be great. That's the Wednesday night before Thanksgiving. I'm excited about next week. I'm excited about going from the bottom to the top. And I'm excited about the fact that when you are thankful, miracles happen in that moment more than any other time. And that's gonna be great. This Wednesday night's gonna be great. You don't wanna miss it. And I'm just so excited about what God is doing. Now, I am believing that God is going to heal you. You're not going to fall and hit the ground. You're not going to crash. The eagle, the Father's going to pick you up, and you're going to go and rest upon His wings. And I want to say to somebody, you're on His wings, and He's headed back up to the nest, the spiritual nest, in which He's getting ready to readjust, to take you higher than you've ever been before. Father, I thank you today because that person who's hurting, that person who's questioning, that person who has fear, that person who needs health, that person who needs help in their marriage, Lord, with their children. God, that miracle they've been praying for, Lord, I release that right now. Lord, as I push that person, the person watching me, push them with their faith as the mother eagle push the eaglets out. Lord, I push every person that needs something to do a miracle. Don't worry about, oh no, I don't know if I can do it or not. The Father will always be there to catch you. Thank you, Lord. I'm so excited about what God's doing in your life. If you'd like to give to this ministry, I hope you'll do it today. We're just a few $1,000s short from our new cameras, and they're on. I hope the picture is better. And we are so excited about as God's kingdom is expanding. Until next week, or until Wednesday night, get ready. God's going to do great things in your life. I am believing that for you.